week is Mark Statman, S-T-A-T-M-A-N. And his most recent book is called Exile Home. And that's what it's all about. You're going to hear some poems from that book. But also, he is a celebrated translator of Garcia Lorca, and he translated Lorca's probably best book, and it's a wonderful book, Poet in New York. And he's a New Yorker, and that's another reason why he did it, and it had something to do with the Twin Towers disaster as well, coming back at New York in a new way, but using Lorca to do it. We're just delighted that he's here, and he's going to be regaling you with his poetry and translations.
Hi, Jack. Thank you so much for having me. This has been really, what a wonderful afternoon I've had just chatting with you about poetry and life. Thank you for the gift.
Is there a difference?
No, there isn't. Well, maybe for some people, but not for us. Green Side Up, from my father, Al Statman, 1933 to 2018. Green Side Up. One. That was the joke, the saying, to look out the window, to think the green side is up. There's the sun, there are the mountains, dry and bright in your Arizona. Two, take with you your stickball memories, Brooklyn, Bronx. You wake up from a hospital dream, you'd hit two sewers, something won. Three, on the phone, you'd say it's another DIP dip day in paradise. Waking early enough, there was no sound of morning, only birdsong breeze, the meaning of paradise, that first moment alone and taking in coffee and sunlight. Four. Growing up, I would sit with you at the kitchen table. Pre-dawn, you ate cereal. It was before you were off to work. I thought I should sit with you, someone should sit with you. I would, then you'd go off to work. I'd go for a run or back to sleep. Who remembers what we said? I remember silence. Five. A kiss and a bop on the head. It's what you gave us. Then that last kiss, no bop, you were already too weak. You couldn't move your hands, but you could kiss. You could smile that smile that split your face, the world, in two. Six. What did you say, that for breakfast your father had a shot of whiskey, an onion, and off to the bakery, ready for the work of the day? Seven. Water, one of your elements, watching you from the shore as you dove into one wave after another like some water god. Eight. But one day we were swimming across a boat channel in the Florida Keys. You said, I'm in trouble. Who was always there to save us from trouble? I hailed a passing boat. They pulled us in. Your first heart attack, your first trouble. The many troubles, the gods fall. Gods always fall. They are meant to fall. They are meant to give us stories and disappear. Nine. And Mom is crying, as angry as grief. She wanted to be the first to go. She wanted you to be the one to live alone. That isn't how she means it, but the loneliness you've left her. You hid your cancer. You did this to everyone. Never wanting to be thought as sick. Never wanting to be the problem. 10. When you turned 40, you joked, well, now I guess I'll never play center field. Beloved DiMaggio, beloved Mantle, beloved Yankees. 11. My sons, my legacy, my history, you said to the doctor, have you met my son, the poet? They are dying. You let me know you knew. 12. Singing lines from musical, movies, Broadways, the night they invented champagne. 13. Your voice is made for radio, or reimagined, so I imagine. I can hear it now going out across the airwaves. Al Statman here. Good morning. 14. Nothing ahead and nothing behind, which is to say present, which is to say nothing at all except this. Holding your hand, holding you hold onto life a little longer. 15. You opened your eyes, you were in so much pain, you said, did you ever think your father was such a baby? 16. It didn't matter the story, you just loved to tell a story, or maybe it was all the stories. Maybe you were saying, here is your inheritance. 17. Driving through Canada on the way to Montreal, you bought a beret and sang Frère Jacques. One time, 10 times, 100 times, a secret happiness that wasn't secret. 18. I'd call your phone, you'd say hello and ask me how I was doing. Then you'd say, here's your mother. And I'd say, but Dad, I'm calling you. 19. Who goes rock hunting? We go rock hunting. Driving along Long Island back roads looking for boulders we'd heave into the car to decorate the yard. 20. When you were a boy davening in shul, an old man behind you smacked your head because in your broken Hebrew he said you'd called God an SOB. 21. I don't want to forget anything, not your anger, not your love. I don't want to forget maybe I disappointed you. Sunday mornings growing up, you made pancakes. We listened to New York Football Giants games. Names like Ron Johnson, Fran Tarkenton, Spider Lockhart. 22. We asked you what you did at work. You said, I sharpen pencils. 23. You talked about your golf game, but I never saw you play. You were proud of the athlete, me. Once I overheard you say to a friend, have you ever seen Mark run? 24. When you decided you'd had enough, you said you wanted to go home, to leave the hospital. No more tubes, no more machines, no more beeping sounds. You were going to die in the sounds of your own house, the familiar, the loved. You had the voices there of your family who had come to say, we love, we love, we love, who had come to say, please, and stay, and then, goodbye. 25. You told me the story of Becky under the stairs, the first girl ever kissed. 26. In the hospital, I shaved you. You hadn't shaved in days. Gray stubble, gray skin, and you look somehow better, almost ready to live. I cleaned your glasses, filthy when you came home. I fed you strawberries, blueberries. Later, David did the same, the last food you'd eat on earth. 27. What worried you, you wouldn't say, except finally in your final days, take care of your mother. Take care of your mother. It had been your job more than 65 years, and now could you trust your sons? But how could we, the way you could? How could we manage her suddenly empty life? 28. You loved having been Air Force. You never talked about it. But when all your sons were small, you would lift us up, lift us high. You'd sing, into the air, Junior Birdman. Into the air, upside down. 29. To see your coffin. To touch your coffin. To spill earth on your coffin. To see the row after row of graves. To see the rolling green of this military cemetery. To know your green side is above. To know, I think each day, green side up. I mean, I think of you. Suave Patria, for Efrain Velasco Sosa. And that comes from the Lopez Velarde poem, one of the great Mexican poets, the greatest Mexican poets. Suave Patria. No man is an island, no woman, no child. His river is cloud, his mountain is ocean. Unconstrained, unwept, untouched, all are by sound and cruelty, by love and poetry. The kind of love held in one's arms, the kind of cruelty that comes with the territory of hope, with threat, desire. The poem makes proposals for the world. Take, hold, watch. When ice breaks in spring, what if there is no spring? No renewal, no rain. What there is no ice, a blessing was the morning moon, the midday sun, the march of over, and blood far away. We don't have to hear and smell it. What we know by word of mouth. From ear to ear, we learn the cold has come, and the snows have come. The trees have broken from the weight from ice we've longed for to be far away and more now like that the days. Territory. A blonde day of no account as we stumble, the rocks, spheres, sapphires, unlocked accents. No one can place, no one knows who you are, you could be anyone. Celebration and odyssey that build into days in which life says, rest from your omega, alpha, gamma. Nightfall. What goes with you when you go? What do you leave behind? What do you hold on to? What? Pots, pans, knives, winter, clothes, bookcases, books. What? Tables, chairs, a couch, a bed. What? Given, forgiven, we sat on the stoops and neighbors and friends of decades. They refuse to believe. How can you believe? How can you leave this? Your Brooklyn skyline, your Brooklyn sky, your... Los Cambios. We call the casita the country, as though it distills into its small, unrolling green every rural place we've ever loved. In Centro Oaxaca, we call Brooklyn, because 3,000 miles south, west, it contains in itself a Brooklyn self, a Brooklyn soul. My mother said, "You sound happy there, at the casita, with its mountains and valley made of wood and adobe and green cantera stone." My mother is old. She's sick. Some days she forgets, but her radar works. Happy, she said. Happy. How not? In the long unfolding suddenness of where you ought to be. Destination. This isn't destiny the way the word means, though destined might take us all the way to the midday meal. I think it should be on the porch or patio. It's good to eat outside. We'll have meat and tortillas. Someone might have a mezcal or beer, others lemonade or water. Can you believe we live like this? Is it what we were coming to those years ago in the plans, though not as I remember them? I remember sleepy towns, dusty towns, as we drank the beer, the mezcal. I don't remember thinking, this is where I'm going. La gente se muere que muera, pero tú sigas siendo lo mismo, said an older man to a friend even older. They were online at a food stand at Llano Park. The people die, they die, but you keep on the same. He might have said the sky today, or those trees, all the unseen changing written glass and water clouds. This is the last poem I'm going to read from Exile Home, and then I'm going to switch over to Garcia Lorca. You should have seen, is the title of the poem. You should have seen how all the young girls were dancing in a circle. They were holding hands. They were flowers or autumn. They were dancing in, they with each other. There was no music. We could see only how their skirts moved, their arms moved, their bodies moved. They were in their own circle, their own world, their own lives. They trapped us. They enchanted us. We who disappeared in the end. It was one of the great gifts of my life to be able to translate with Pablo Medina, Garcia Lorca's poet in New York, arguably one of the greatest books of poetry written in the 20th century. And we translated it because of the collapse of the, because of the destruction of the World Trade Center. And it just moved us to do that. And so I'm going to read two poems from Poet New York. One is The Cry Toward Rome, from the tower of the Chrysler Building. Apple slightly wounded by fine short swords of silver, cloud scraped by hand of coral with an almond of fire on its back, arsenic fish like sharks, sharks like teardrops that blind the crowds, roses that wound and needles installed in the pipes of blonde, enemy worlds and loves covered by worms will fall on you. They will fall in the great dome, the military tongues coat with oil, where a man urinates on a dazzling dove and spits out ground cold surrounded by thousands of handbells. Because there is no one now to offer bread or wine or tend to the grass in the dead man's mouth, no one to open the linens of repose or weep for wounded elephants. There are only a million iron workers forging chains for the children to come. There are only a million carpenters who make coffins without crosses. There is only a crowd of laments that undo their clothes and wait for a bullet. The man who despises the dove should speak, should scream naked among the columns and inject himself with leprosy and cry a lament so horrible it might dissolve his rings and his diamond telephones. But the man in white ignores the mystery of the wheat stalk, ignores the moan of the woman in labor, ignores that Christ can still give water, ignores that the coins burn the prodigal kiss, and he gives the lamb's blood to the idiot beak of the pheasant. Teachers teach children of a marvelous light that comes from the mount, but what comes is a gathering of sewers where the dark nymphs of cholera scream. The teachers point with devotion to the huge censored domes, but beneath the statues there is no love, no love inside the eyes of ultimate crystal. Love is in the flesh torn apart by thirst. Love is in the small shack that struggles with floods. Love is in the pits where the snakes of hunger struggle, in the sad sea that rocks the bodies of dead seagulls, and in the darkest piercing kiss under the pillows. But the old man with translucent hands will say, love, love, until the tissue shaken by tenderness will say, peace, peace, between the shivering knives and the dynamite melons, will say, love, love, until his lips turn to silver. Meanwhile, 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 mientras tanto, mientras tanto, mientras tanto, the blacks who empty the spittoons, the boys tremble before the pale terror of managers, the women drowned in mineral oils, the masses of hammer, violin, or cloud must cry through their, though their brains are smashed against the wall, must cry before the domes, must cry maddened by fire, must cry maddened by snow, must cry with their head full of excrement, must cry like all the nights together, must cry in a voice so broken the cities will tremble like girls and break like the prisons of oil and music, because we want our daily bread, alder flowers and perennial thresh tenderness, because we want the earth's will be done to give its fruits to all. Leonard Cohen, who's a good friend of my wife and her father, made this poem very famous, but the poem is better than Leonard. And do I have time to read it in Spanish? Okay, I'm going to read it in Spanish and then I'll read it in English. Pequeño Valfenes. En Villena hay 10 muchachas en hombro donde se hallase la muerte y un bosque de palomas desecadas. Hay un fragmento de la mañana en el Museo de la Escarcha. Hay un salón con 1000 ventanas. Ay, 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 ay. Toma este vals con la boca cerrada. Este vals, este vals, este vals de sí, de muerte y de cognac que moja su cola en el mar. Te quiero, te quiero, te quiero. Canubataca y el libro muerto por el melancólico pasillo en el oscuro desván delirio. En nuestra cama de la luna y en la danza que sueña la tortuga. Ay, 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 ay. Toma esta vals de quebrada cintura. En Viena hay 4 espejos donde juegan la tuboque y los secos. Hay una muerte para piano que pinta de azul a los muchachos. Hay mendigos por los tejados. Hay frescas guirnaldas de llanto. Ay, 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 ay. Toma esta vals que se muere en mis brazos. Porque te quiero, amor mío, en el desván donde juegan los niños, soñando viejas luces de Hungría, por los rumores de la tarde tibia, donde ovejas y lirios de nieve, por el silencio oscuro de tu frente. Ay, 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 toma esta vals de te quiero siempre. En Viena bailaré contigo con un disfraz que tenga cabeza de río. Mira qué orillas tengo de jacintos. Dejaré mi boca entre tus piernas, mi alma en fotografías y azucenas. Y en las ondas oscuras de tu andar, quiero, amor mío, dejar violín y sepulcro las cintas del vals. Es
small Viennese waltz.
In Vienna, there are 10 girls, a shoulder on which death is sobbing, and a forest of dried-out pigeons. There is a fragment of morning in the Museum of Frost. There is a salon with 1,000 windows. I take this waltz with your mouth closed. This waltz about death, about itself, about death in cognac that wets its tail in the sea. I love you with the armchair and the dead book, through the melancholy hallway, in the dark attic of lilies, on our bed of the moon, and the dance screen by the tortoise. I take this waltz of the broken waist. In Vienna, there are 4 mirrors where your mouth and the echoes play. There is death for the piano that paints the boy's blue. There are beggars on rooftops. There are fresh garlands of weeping. I take this wolf that dies in my arms because I want you, my love, in the attic where the children play, dreaming the old lights of Hungary through the rumors of the warm afternoon, seeing lambs and lilies of snow in the dark silence of your forehead. I take this waltz called I Love You Always. In Vienna, I'll dance with you, wearing a disguise with the head of a river. Look at the hyacinth shores I wear. I will leave my mouth between your legs, my soul in photographs and white lilies. In the dark waves of your journey, I want my love to leave violin and tomb, ribbons of waltz.
And we have time for a few more from Exile Home.
Fair to say, living in two languages creates a third like living in two houses, or like the way I am in love with the presence of love. So here, so many years is a singular love, though like the sky, like the earth, unchanging and unchanging, with all the lived-in rooms and all the words. The twist of fate. The air is full with ribbons, the colors of Mexico and not the USA, and I don't mind. I'm in the middle of a different story. One where the ribbons come down, the stars come down, the story full of blessings. We are the blessed. The air full of green, songs of red, white, and green in ribbons. Night manners. With all the barking dogs on their rooftops, you wonder how the owners survive the noise, the piercing, the constant loyal menace. Casita Cannonball. 1. We bought a house, a country cottage, and we named it Casita Cannonball for our loved Cannonball, now gone. The old Zen dog, old black lab, would have liked it here, meditating on his paws, quiet, his unscripted life. His great-great-nephew, the chocolate Labrador Apollo, who sometimes wanders around the big house we rent in Oaxaca Centro, the Primera Privada de Crespo. That was Cannonball's last. He'd sun himself in the front courtyard on the back patio, a small happiness for us that in his last year, his hips barely working, he didn't have to bear a Brooklyn winter. Casita Cannonball is in the Colonia Rancho Buena Vista, Primera Privada de Libertad, the San Pedro Islahuaca, surrounded by mountains and farms and valley. There are 3 bulls in the field next to us right now. Later will come goats and pigs, more bulls, 2 dogs. Apollo wonders at it all. He barks and the 2 dogs bark back at their new loud neighbor. Roosters crow, tanagers in flight call. A thunderstorm is coming. It's all country noise except for the silence the cannonball brings. He's everywhere here, so in his final home he'll be. 2. The mountains sit like clouds and the clouds like clouds and mountains, shadows of each other and each other shadowing and shining. Together and with the birds, the radio from that old car down the road, Rancheras Chilenas Tango, they are this morning, even for our indoors, which looks out with coffee and tea and mango papaya plátano on the table. Los Cambios. We call the casita the country as though it distills into its small unrolling green every rural place we've ever loved. In Centro Oaxaca, we call Brooklyn because 3,000 miles southwest, it contains in itself a Brooklyn self, a Brooklyn soul. My mother said, you sound happy here at the casita with its mountains and valley made of wooden adobe and green cantera stone. My mother is old, she's sick. Some days she forgets, but her radar works. Happy, she said, happy. How not in the long unfolding suddenness of where you ought to be. Mi México. To understand the welcome, become the stranger in the room that lights the house, that lights the street with white, and yellow with something like talk, something like music, a wind, a voice, a heart, a sound, a welcome, welcome morning, welcome night. We say to each other, come in, come, over, we'll hear say, enter. Flight. You'd have to think the air could hold pieces of eight and pieces of silver, or that the burden of temptation was the burden of mist and the burden of trees, a rowboat of decision across the water so slow this morning because in morning, lightning into music. The Tijuanas have gone home, have left their orange and black flowers in the streets. An accordion plays, accordion songs. A street sweeper leaves the flowers. He leaves, the boy, his accordion, the little girl asking pesos with her wooden bowl. He sweeps the headlines, newspaper dust. He sweeps sometimes the air. Leaf to leaf. Over the years, things happen, and over this past year, we changed. A universe, we changed. We left Brooklyn, we arrived Oaxaca, and then later San Pedro y Slovaca. It isn't the same sky or sun. It isn't the same language. Every day, new words, which is new ideas, which is new meaning, which is new world, which means usually pleasantly and not unfamiliar. Some mornings, the way the clouds drift the mountains, remembering 6 months of dry season almost, no clouds at all, so the clouds are part of the mountains, and are as the mountains, and are of as sky as sky. So the unfamiliar becomes easier, normal. The unfamiliar is so normal in a dream, so normal for nothing to make sense. So in strangeness, you relax, you sleep.
That was Mark Statman reading from two of his recent books, Exile Home and With Pedro Medina, a translation of Garcia Lorca's great Poeta en Nueva York, Poet in New York. About Exile Home, Anne Waldman writes, it is a love poem to the poet's adopted country, so fresh in the poem Mi México. The air, the light, the poignancy of little girl with wooden bowl and mystery of life next to another, a beloved partner, buzz with sharp grace. A contrast across the border with family loss, but no walls here. Power of all the unseen, written glass in water clouds. Join the fiesta. No ideas, but in things. I want to go there, too. This is a sweet and pungent sensory exile. Almost a dream. And John Ashbery wrote of the translation of Poeta en Nueva York, Pablo Medina and Mark Statman have produced the definitive version of Lorca's masterpiece in language that is as alive and molten today as was the original in 1930.
And this is Jack Foley. Happy St. Patrick's Day. Stay at home. Listen to the radio. And thank you, Lucretia Burton, for board hopping. Thanks to all my listeners for listening.
Referendum is underway, and as a member, you have a right to vote on whether to replace the current bylaws with the proposed bylaws. Proponents state that decisive action needs to be taken now because the Pacifica Foundation is in dire financial straits that threaten its viability as a growing concern. Opponents state that the referendum itself is being pushed through in a process lacking transparency, and that democratically elected boards have the best chance of resolving financial concerns while preserving the network as a whole. For more info, visit elections.pacifica.org or leave a message on 510 931-7504. Be sure to cast your ballot by 11:59 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on March 19th.
Welcome to Cover to Cover.
Knowing your stuff, you've explored religion in your work, and I think that's your current body of work too,
yeah.
Right? Yeah.
I want to say it's very different from this, but it's also connected, honestly. So
different than what?
From my mom's series.
From your mom's series.
Is really what started everything, right? Like, just really quick overview. After I painted things about my mom, everything just got really bright in color. All my paintings after then, they were very self-exploratory. I started painting about myself and really looking inwards and seeing who I am as a woman, as a Korean American, as, you know, just me and my culture and history and heritage. And now I am working on a series called Souls in Motion, and it's a giant triptych that is kind of like my Korean mythological folk version of, if you're familiar with Hieronymus Bosch, he did the Garden of Earthly Delights. He was commissioned by a church, so it's a religious painting with like Adam and Eve in the first panel, and then there's this oasis of everyone like having sex and like giant fruits on their head and crazy stuff going on the second panel, and the third panel is a depiction of hell on earth. So I'm painting my version of that, but with less fear put into it and more about the positive things about our life and where we are right now. And it's really about love. It's about finding love. And it all stemmed from actually a DMT trip that I took. I don't know if you're familiar with DMT, but
no.
It's a hallucinogen. It's found naturally in some plants.
Right. No, I've done hallucinogens, so I'm not familiar with that one. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Right. Right.
It's amazing. It's
so what happened on this here trip?
Well, basically, it's like, so I saw God. Mm-hmm. I didn't see him. Mm-hmm. There was no physical being. I just felt him, and I just felt a lot of love. And it's like he just welcomes me and took me by the hand and was like, hey, I'm going to show you what this world is really like. So he took me through seeing like the earth being formed from space, dinosaurs roaming and dying, and these fish forms coming out of the water and becoming chimpanzees and becoming the humans we are. Mm-hmm. And then I got shot into space. I was in this vast darkness, and I was looking back down on our earth with the presence of God and love and all of this just overwhelming me. And I just felt a lot of love. And really, it just reconfirmed for me what I already believed about us and the universe and how we're all made of the same stardust. And, you know, love is what really keeps us going. It might not solve everything and solve all our problems, but it helps us keep pushing forward. So I wanted to depict that. It's not an exact depiction, the final product, but it's my version of that.
So love keeps us going.
Yeah. That's what I believe.
And so now, in the way the world seems to be falling apart, politically, economically, and some people say that democracy, as we've known it, or believed we thought we had. There are some people who actually don't believe that there was really ever democracy in this country based on some of the ways in which this country started. Where is the presence of love? Or how can, as artists, we discover the presence of love to sort of counter or have that conversation in this here mix that we're inside of, this political, economical mix? We have the homeless crisis, that is, and both of you've been in the Bay Area, and I'm not sure if you're aware, like even in San Francisco, everywhere. I mean, I was just talking to my mother who was in Paris a few years ago, and she said it was just her dream of going to Paris and getting there, and the sense of homelessness everywhere around was just devastating. Mm-hmm. So what is it about love? You're exploring it in your art. Mm-hmm. And I know that's a big question, but how, what is love? What is it? What did God tell you?
Oh, and would it have been anything
about love? But sure, what did God show you? I noticed it was a man.
Well, honestly, there was no like gender attached.
But okay, but where? So, how did you know it was love?
That's a hard question. I just knew. I felt it.
Yeah,
I could sense it. It's quite a mysterious thing. Mm-hmm. It's really hard to explain, and you know, I think it just goes across all relationships. There's actually a Korean word that I just thought of that is not exactly love. There's no direct translation in English, but it's in Korean it's called chang. And you could kind of say it's like an attachment for someone or even a something. Mm-hmm. But you could say, like, I'll think of a sentence. You grew up with like a sibling or something. You guys grew up like fighting all the time and had like a really bad relationship. But once you guys leave and you think about your sibling, you have this love, not exactly love and hate, but you have this chung for them. And you can't help but, like, they are your tie, they are your blood, and you feel for them. You could say something like that, or maybe, like, a blanket you had growing up and you can't, like, detach from. You have a tongue with that blanket. It's very mysterious, and I think there's a lot of people who try to figure out what it is, and it's through art, it's through words like this, through expression. The best can do, I guess, the closest thing we can do.
And I think that has to do with our the human consciousness. I think it's evolving. And I think that artists, as we talked earlier, brings us deeper into consciousness through our art. And I think at the turn of every century, from what I've studied and understand, artists help people to open their consciousness even deeper, sort of like the hallucinogenic you took. Art sometimes opens people up. Mm-hmm. What's your take on love?
Well, I listening to kind of what you were saying, what resonated with me a lot just is that love is like connection. It's when you connect with somebody and you're offering like unconditional kindness to them, and then receiving it. And maybe it's not equal, but there's something there that's connecting you to. And that's, I think, what I think love is. It's, I guess it's just like being without terms, just caring for somebody. And thinking of my experience when I lived in the Bay Area, I lived in the Tenderloin, and I experienced, it was just a very different place. And I struggled at first with so many people living on the streets and just being in an environment that was maybe traditionally not pretty. There's definitely some charm there. There's a lot of charm there. But it took me a minute to appreciate it and to see it, because there was other things more in the forefront that distracted me.
And what's an example that you were able, first of all, I think the whole concept of love is a connection, then that would, when I think about the picture of our culture breaking apart because people are feeling disconnected by the politics that we have. So that, I think both your answers and agreeing on that is absolutely, love is about connection, right? Mm-hmm. So when you were able to live in the Tenderloin, I'm curious, what is it that at the forefront, there's homelessness, there's addiction, et cetera. What happened to you that you were able to see something else that was beautiful, which is, I think, what we're doing with our, with art, trying to see what we can extract from that, the beauty that, that we can experience through even abandonment. Something comes out of that. What did you see?
I think, you know, it was a challenge to just accept my surroundings because it was different. And once I got through that process, it was, instead of these people are strangers that live over here or there, it was more like these people are my neighbors, you know, like I am part of this community. And the change of thought of, oh, you are that or something, you know, it was more like, oh, you're also me. Like we are just people. And I think that's that connection of just, you know, without terms, you know, just accepting people for who they are, because you're expecting them to do the same for you, right?
There's you just reminded me of a line in a movie with Barbara Streisand. She's in a psychiatric ward because she just killed her killed someone. Mm-hmm. He was a client. She was his. She was his call girl, and it got ugly. She killed him because it was ugly for her life. But she's in this psychiatric room, and the psychiatrist, who's a horrible person, is a male person, very patriarchal and very demeaning. He's talking to her, and she says to him, sort of reminded me, she says, it's funny. You're doubting me because I'm a call girl, but isn't it interesting that we ended up in the same place, different roles, but you are here every day the way I'm in the same place with people struggling with problems. You're just a psychiatrist, but you're here. We're in the same ear. We're in this together. And mm-hmm. So that's what I'm hearing in your story, that we go into stories with stories of our own, like what's normal, what's mm-hmm. traditional, what's et cetera. And then suddenly, for some reason, you recognize we're in this story together. I live mm-hmm. here.
Yeah.
I live here with you. We're together.
Mm-hmm.
We're us. What are we thinking about consciousness in as artists? What do you want your work to do? What do you want? If somehow the universe said, both of you as women artists, painters, textile, clothing, you're determined to make sure that there's not just mass clothing, you want to offer something else, to support the environment, for women to find clothes in their body that reflects nature and to flow in it and move in it and fill their bodies with gratitude, whatever they do.
Mm-hmm.
Here you are exploring religion and mythologies and change of story and searching for love at the same time, having paintings and postcards in search of your mother, the greatest act of all. And we're all in search of our mothers, even when our mothers were right there with us. We're in search of our mothers in some way, right?
Mm-hmm.
Shape or form. What is it that the two of you want your work to do if you had the power of whatever you do to change consciousness? What would that look like? What consciousness would you like to be pushed or opened?
Yeah, I think it's something that I always thought of when I was younger and trying to pursue her more seriously. I just want people to feel. I just want people to have emotions. And when they look at my art, I want that to be like a gateway for them to, you know, open up things inside them that might be maybe not even super happy. Maybe it's a little bit dark. Maybe it's conflicting. Maybe it's, you know, just to have that kind of impact.
Ah, okay. Because that's what happened to you with your therapist.
Yeah.
You actually opened up a space in you that you were quiet about for a year. Mm-hmm. And you want to give that gift in many ways to your art. That's deep. That's deep.
Mm-hmm.
Where are you at?
I just want to make clothing that brings people happiness, I guess, or like when they put it on, they feel comfortable in their skin, that this is who they are, this is what they want to represent to the world, and just to feel good in it.
Mm-hmm. And about where it came from, that it's
not
produced somewhere where we follow the chain and find out that someone's making the clothing under horrible conditions for nothing at all.
Mm-hmm.
And then by the time it hits the store, it's $300, and the person that made it somewhere for 3 cents an hour.
Mm-hmm.
That we began to find other ways of loving even folks that we may never see in our lives, mm-hmm. right? How can folks get a hold of you to see your work online, to bring it closer into their own lives? What is what's your information?
Yeah, I have a website. My brand is Okika Cloth. So you can find me online. I'm also
build that out for them.
Sure. So OKIKACLOTH.com. And I'm on Instagram as well. And then we be doing a few pop-ups in February, next weekend, at Balia Boutique in Honolulu, Chinatown, and then the Aloha Home Market in Kailua the following Sunday. So I'll be on the streets pretty soon.
You'll be on the streets pretty soon. What about, will you be going back to the Bay to you know, to do your work or sell anything there, or,
yeah,
or take an order?
Right. Yeah, I'd love to leap over the pond. I think right now, because I'm so small, I'm kind of trying to get established here. I'm definitely not opposed to it being in other outlets. But yeah, I'd love to eventually also, you know, be international, like Japan, and just kind of spread mm-hmm. across, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. reach your closet.
Mm-hmm. How we get hold of you?
I have a website, www.laurenhanachai.com. That's LaurenHana, like Pau Hana, and then Chai, like the tea.com, also on Instagram. And coming up, I will be a powwow artist for 2020, so you can find me painting on Cook Streets from the 10th, for a week.
And what kind of artist did you just say?
Powwow. So there's a street festival here that goes on where all those street artists come out and paint the walls in Kakaako.
Okay.
So, yeah, it'll be a fun week.
Okay. What... So in being in this world, you both are taking your art and you're taking it to the next level. You're thinking you want to go your art all over the world. You have a traveling show that you're in search of your mother, every location you know. What has been inside of this story, both of your stories, some of the highlights that you've learned about yourself? And then what has been some of the challenges that has been hard on yourself?
Yes.
Think about it. You want to go?
Sure. Yes. Yeah. So I have learned a lot about how I handle, I guess, situations that are challenging. Or so I like kind of being in the background. I like doing my art and you know, hustling and working and in, you know, midnight hour, or all night long for that matter. But being out there in the front, and being like a representative for myself and my brand, that's a challenge. I can be a little bit shy or soft-spoken sometimes. So, it's been a very long, like, learning process of, you know, one project after the other to get this line developed of really challenging that fear. And what I've learned, which it seems like such a simple concept, but if you don't say anything, nothing happens.
Let's just breathe that one in.
Yeah.
For people who are watching and listening, if you don't say anything, nothing will happen.
Yeah. And I learned that one time and time again, where I got to that point where this is the point where I need to make that call. I need to reach out with that email, or I need to walk into that store and talk to this person, and I froze or I was stuck, and it took me a minute to get to that next step. But every single time you find out that, you know, if you didn't say that, then this couldn't have happened. So it's been, you know, it's still challenging, but I have to keep pushing myself to get past that, to where it isn't a challenge anymore. But I won't be able to unless I keep practicing that.
I really appreciate you facing that part of yourself, saying that you are normally a shy person, hours doing your work,
mm-hmm.
and having to go out there in the world and speak in a way that you're not accustomed to, but pushing past that. And mm-hmm. I hope those watching, those listening, are able to see if they can hold up close to them and just say, I'll say something. Because mm-hmm. I'm sure there's times you said something and it may not have worked in your favor.
Definitely. Yeah. I mean, but you won't know until you try.
Until you try.
Yeah. That's the other one, is that, you know, you can plan so much, and I love planning. I'm a super analyst. I like to do all my research, figure out what my next move is, and then I'll make the move. And sometimes that isn't the right move, and it just, that part falls apart, and you have to redirect and figure out a different path. But I wouldn't know that until I try it. So that's the other really simple one, but a huge learning, you know, lesson that I've experienced. You just got to do it. You just got to say it.
You just got to. What came up for you?
Actually, as you were talking about that, I realized that I'm like the complete opposite in a sense. In terms of like risk taking, like going for it, and like sometimes a little too much and no planning and just like jumping in. And yeah, there's good and bad to that. Like planning is good. It really is, to an extent. Thinking things through and not just acting before thinking. So that was a big thing that I struggled with early on, like towards graduation, and then as an early emerging artist, I've made so many mistakes. I've burned so many bridges. I wasn't very professional in that sense. You know, all that, which I'm trying to get better at now. And you know, let's hold on. Let's think. We're jumping into this. And yeah, it's very important. I could learn from you, probably.
Yeah, likewise.
We can learn from each other. Isn't that the part of it? Just being able to connect.
Yeah.
Speaking of love. So now, do you teach classes?
I do, actually, yeah.
Here's my question. I want to play pretend, but you're actually a teacher. If you were in front of your students, what would be, what is the very first lesson you'd want to teach them about doing the work that you do?
Mm-hmm.
What is something you want to say to them? And what do you say?
Yeah, I think that the process of creating is extremely important. I think you learn a lot about yourself through that process. So when I'm introducing a new technique or a different medium to my students, I just try to create an environment of like acceptance and, you know, creativity and exploration. Like all of these parts of the process are very important and natural for them to kind of work through. You know, you try something and it didn't turn out the way you want, you can't hold your hand steady to make that stroke or whatever it is that you're doing, and that's okay. And sometimes those accidents, you know, happy accidents, it's like they all add to the final product. And with screen printing and textile design, you know, when I was in school, you couldn't command Z, undo, you know, like these design programs where you can just constantly undo the last step you did. But once you print, it's there. So you kind of have to work with what you put on the fabric. So I think that's just really important to
be for them to take away the very first lesson,
right,
that you want to impose on them.
Right.
It's just, this is important.
Yeah.
Do you teach?
I have taught one class.
Okay.
It was a 6 or 8 week course, once a week. I don't think I could teach again. It is, man, props to you, because teaching is so hard. It's a whole nother.
What grade level were you teaching?
Well, it was open to students 14 and up. So
okay.
I actually had more people, probably late 20s to early 40s.
Well, what happened?
It was an expressionism class. So
yeah.
It's less about academic painting and more about opening yourself up and expressing yourself through whatever medium you choose.
Okay.
I just personally think I should have priced up with something easier, like teaching a basic circle. Because
yeah.
It's a lot to teach. It's really difficult to
teach someone to open up.
Yeah.
Because that process itself can be a lot of emotional drama going on and resistance.
Yes.
Resistance.
Yes.
Resistance. Mm-hmm. So in our last few minutes of hanging out as women, as artists, and looking at the space between us, what has held y'all together in your journey with art, and what has maybe pushed you further, like you learning to be out in the public space and you understanding that you would rather teach circles than to be teaching someone to open up, because that's a whole nother talk show, right?
Yes.
And so in these moments, you both are in relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes as artists, we find it hard for someone to
understand all the detail that goes into being an artist, which are not traditional, a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
What makes it work for you and your partners?
Mm. My fiancé is an artist too, so
mm-hmm.
we work.
We work.
We work, yeah.
Yes, so, and sometimes it doesn't with two artists, but y'all have made it work.
Well, we've made it work, and we're opposites too. Even though we are both painters, we paint opposite things, we have opposite personalities, but it bounces off on each other, and we learn a lot from each other. You know, yeah. He keeps me grounded and not going bouncing off the walls crazy.
So right.
It really works. I get him to come out of his shell a little bit more and like work for things more. So it's a nice trade off. And, you know, it's just love. It's love. Yeah.
It's love. Yeah. It's connecting you.
Mm-hmm.
How you do it.
Yeah. I would say our relationship is, he is extremely supportive of everything that I do and just always wants to help and be a part of it. Mm-hmm. And that's very rewarding to me because I get to then share what I'm doing with him. And, you know, I'm recently starting teaching. So as I'm working with him on something, I'm kind of having to explain certain things. And, you know, that process has in turn helped me become a better teacher.
Because you're fleshing it out.
Yeah, because I'm explaining it. And being able to share that workspace with him and, you know, bring him in and him be a part of it, it's really special. And we get to spend more time together because we're just both working together. And I really love that part of it.
So where are you teaching?
So I teach at the Honolulu Academy of Art School. I do a screen printing textile design class for adults and then sewing and fiber art for youth.
So you love the art of teaching?
I do. I really do.
Do you see that some of the students coming in are also possibly going to be making changes that you're making changes in, like in terms of being more mindful of the clothes and whatever, however they take that journey, the political and social things that we mm-hmm. can bring into our work?
Yeah.
Are you including that in your curriculum?
Definitely. So the school really encourages a type of... Oh, good.
I got to say goodbye.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're
Thank
welcome.
You. Thank you.
Thank you.
Cut that driver off. Cut off that nonsense you're listening to on the radio. And put it on 94.1 KPFA. Starting at 3 p.m. for your daily digest of independent analysis, investigation, and activism on Rising Up with Sonali, followed by news, views, and hip-hop on Hard Knock Radio at 4. Then it's hard-hitting frontline investigative reporting on flashpoints at 5, followed by a comprehensive wrap-up of the day's news and events with the Pacifica Evening News at 6. That's weekday afternoons starting at 3 p.m. on KPFA and kpfa.org.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.